Joseph Holt, been the curator for this set of four sessions we've had on the versatile piano, versatile pianist, and it's been a pleasure to highlight various aspects of pianist careers here. And today we're going to focus in on the solo pianist, the pianist that works within the orchestra, and the chamber pianist. And I'm so delighted that my wonderful colleague Gail Berenson is joining me for this. She's going to take the second half of the program, and I'm going to work with you on the first half of the program. So, we played for you the first movement of a Mozart sonata that was originally written for four hands piano, and that's something that we've not highlighted whatsoever in this particular set of piano sessions. But we thought it'd be appropriate, since we're talking about piano, you know, as a solo instrument, but also piano as a chamber instrument. This is something that rarely happens. I mean, pianists usually are stuck in a practice room by themselves for hours, upon days, upon weeks, upon months, and we rarely get a chance to work with each other. I mean, it's just sort of a rarity, so it's kind of nice that we can do that today. And it actually has quite a few challenges because, as you can imagine, everybody has their own unique touch. And that's the, you know, there's a speed at which the key goes down. So sometimes you'll hear things just exactly, or sometimes you'll hear it as, that's because there's different touches that are happening, and you really have to work very hard to coordinate that to make sure that you are touching the piano as correctly as possible, you know, evenly. And the other thing that has to happen is you have to choreograph, because frequently, you know, the fifth finger of the person who's playing the bass is conflicting with the fifth finger of the person who's playing the treble. So you have this constantly happening, where your fifth fingers are knocking at each other, basically. So you have to work on that also to make sure you don't injure your partner. Or at least you make sure your nails are cut short. So I thought I would just talk a little bit about my career, who I am, and how I came about. And that's part of what we've done in this. Like everyone else who's spoken over these past 8 weeks, we've had, it's been a, everybody has their own journey, right? So mine started out rather uniquely, just like everyone else's in the sense that, but I was given a choice. As a young man, I was asked, do I want to go into the Cub Scouts? Do I want to play Little League? Or do I want to take piano lessons? And because those are the days of the 60s where you weren't actually allowed to do more than one thing, you know, unlike today where kids seemingly have a myriad of activities that they're participating in on a daily basis or a weekly basis. You really wanted to find something that would focus the kid. And so those are my three choices. And you'll never guess which one I took. Now, I took piano lessons mainly because my grandmother was a pianist. And she was quietly lobbying me behind the scenes, saying, you really do need to take piano lessons. And it was actually a good thing because at a young age, I was a bit of a challenge for my parents. If you can imagine, I was the instigator for a lot of things in the neighborhood. I was an imp, and I'm also a preacher's kid. So I had that going for me. And I was also hyperactive, and my parents really needed to find something that they could put me into that would channel this energy. And fortunately, the piano was that vehicle. And I took to it readily. By the end of the first year, I was already playing the first movement of the Moonlight Sonata of Beethoven. And like everyone else, we started off with the John Thompson teaching little fingers to play. You know, I see some heads nodding. You all understand exactly what that is. And it was a little bit like, you know, the reading primer books we had about Jane, you know, See Jane Run, et cetera, but that's what it was for piano. This is exactly what these were. And my favorite piece that I had to play, you know, within a couple of months of lessons was the Little Wigwam. So I don't know if you all remember this, but this is how it goes. It's kind of, I guess, unusual and cruel that I really remember that after all these years. But it really stuck with me, you know, as a young student. And I just find that it was just so, you know, unusual and exotic, you know, and great. So that was one of the first recital pieces I ever had to play. Along the way, we've all had our experiences that have given us, you know, informed us. And one of them happened early on. The teacher that I was working with was actually a harpist, and she was the principal harpist of the Atlanta Symphony. And she was also the wife of the music director at my dad's church. So that's the connection. And she had, you know, like everybody, you know, these recitals. Maybe you had to get up and play, you know, two or three times a year in front of your colleagues, your peers, and, you know, sort of get more experience playing in front of an audience and developing that confidence. Well, for one of these, every single person that stood up to play was making huge mistakes. I mean, they couldn't remember things. They were rewriting it on the spot. They were, you know, playing wrong notes and all sorts of stuff. And my mom, who was sitting next to me, leaned over and said, "You're not going to do that. You're going to show them how it really goes." And she kept repeating this several times, so much so that when it came time for me to get up and play, I actually went out of the room and went into the bathroom where I probably got sick. So, after that experience, so I didn't play that thing. After that experience, the student studio where my peers, you know, and friends, came up to me and said, "We know what you're supposed to play at the next recital. Can you let us know if you're going to be sick so we can play it? Because we'd rather play it than ever." Well, that was my challenge, and I never got sick again. But just interesting little life lessons you learn along the way about playing and stuff. So I'm going to demonstrate a little bit of the, you know, the solo aspect of playing. And so I thought I'd play a few things for you today. First thing we're going to start off with is a delightful sonata by Padre Antonio Soler. Now, how many of you actually heard of the composer Soler? A couple of you. Yeah, that's really good. That's good. Soler was the Spanish counterpart to Domenico Scarlatti. Scarlatti was the Italian, but Scarlatti was also working in Madrid. He was working for the royal family in Madrid. Soler was also working for the royal family, but at Escorial, which is outside of Madrid. They had very similar styles. But in Soler's music, you get a little bit more of the Spanish influence. And in this particular piece in D major, you really can hear the castanets. Castanets really comes to the fore in this charming little piece.
Thank you.
delightful piece of, you know, happy and all sorts of stuff. But you do hear that Spanish influence in there, in the castanets. I was attracted to Spanish music by a course I went to in North Carolina. That was at one of the universities there, and it was all about the Spanish influence in piano music. And it was a great course, and that's where I met one of the world's only concert castanet artists. And she and I collaborated together, did performances throughout the East Coast as well as throughout Spain. And it was really a delight to learn this wonderful repertoire through her eyes and ears. And I know that seems a little odd because you think of a castanet player like being part of flamenco or something like that, dancing. She did not dance. She stood there and she played the castanet, interpreting the music. And she is the only concert artist in the world. Really amazing. And so she lived in the D.C. area for a long time. She now lives in St. Pete. So she's very close by. In fact, if any of you were at Piano Grand a couple of years ago that we did at the Opera House, where we did five pianos, she played on that program. That was that concert artist. So she's really extraordinary. As every career goes, as I said, you know, they're all unique and they're all different. When I was in high school, I had a teacher who was really extraordinary. She was a Matte product. There are various teachers in history who are influential, you know, and Matte was one who it's hard to describe this, but it's like, it's just natural use of the hand and the arm. You know, your arm will do this, so you can do this on the piano, things like this, and you use your shoulders and your body in a different way. So I learned all these techniques through her, and she was bound and determined to make me into the next, you know, famous concert pianist. And I, however, had different designs. I had been introduced to musicals. I thought, wow, this is what a great, you know, genre of music this is. And actually, my first professional job was playing for The King and I at a local theater in D.C. When I was only 15 years old. And I waltzed in there just to actually help somebody with an audition. And they said, you play better than the person we've got. We're firing that person and we're hiring you. It didn't quite work out that way. I mean, that sounds like it was really rude to that other person, but it wasn't. They had a party of the ways. So I ended up playing that. And I also, for the first time, heard opera. So you remember in the 70s, there was this incredible movie that came out, The Magic Flute. Ingmar Bergman film, and it was really extraordinary with Håkan Hagegaard and that great cast. So that was my first exposure to opera, and I immediately fell in love with it and started exploring all that great repertoire, and then I found Verdi. So Verdi, one of the great opera composers of the 19th century. And so at that point, I decided I was going to be an opera conductor. I was not going to play the piano. I mean, I could, you know, but I mean, I really wanted to be an opera conductor. So I trucked off to school to college and thought that I was going to be, you know, an opera conductor. They said, no, you're going to be a pianist. So they didn't have a conducting degree at Eastman at that time. So I ended up being a pianist and then got a performance certificate there. And after that, I was headed to New York City because I had, along with, you know, this love of opera and love of musicals, And at home, I would play the piano, my parents would sing. I had a great love for vocal things. So I was also blessed to be able to sight read almost anything. So my teacher said, you need to go to New York City, we're gonna introduce you to all the right people, and you're gonna establish yourself as, at that point, they still called it the word accompanist. We've now changed that towards your collaborative pianist, or just pianist. And they thought that was not going to be my career because I played for every single incoming audition at Eastman for 3 years of all the vocalists, including Renee Fleming. So it was really kind of a heady time to be at Eastman School of Music.
Renee Fleming
was, yes. So I got a chance to meet her, know her, and work with her. There's actually a very funny story about one of the auditionees. She came in. And this is, you know, imagine it's nerve-wracking because this is for the Eastman School of Music. This woman was a contralto. Now, contraltos are low women's voice. And she was gonna sing a whole host of things by Strauss and Wagner and all this heavy duty stuff. And at the end, she was gonna sing Dido's Lament, which seemed rather odd to me as a choice, but okay. But I think they had to show that they could do every style of music. So we rehearsed, we only rehearsed for 15 minutes, and we never got to the purcell. And I thought, they're never gonna ask her for this purcell because that's not her voice. Sure enough, we got into the audition. They asked her for the purcell second thing. Okay. And if you know that piece, it's when I am late. They did last year, this past spring, in Sarasota. It's in three. That's the important thing. She actually sang it in four. When I am late. And so I'm freaking out thinking, how the hell did I play this? So she sadly was not chosen to be a student at the Eastman School of Music. But we were playing for some of those auditions. There was one gal that came in, she was a tiny little thing, and she was so scared. She said, I went to the library to find my edition of what I'm gonna sing. She was gonna sing the waltz from The Merry Widow, which, you know, love. Da, 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 da. Right? She said, I couldn't find my edition. So if I sing it in German, can you play it in French? And I said to her, oh, don't worry about it, don't worry about it. We were taught to play in any language here at school. So after Eastman, I came back to the DC area and worked as a freelance musician for about 8 years. And then I did something kind of radical. I joined the United States Army. And I became the pianist for the United States Army Band. And that's where I basically spent my career in DC for 20 years, playing for presidents, royalty, members of Congress, all the military brass, and primarily in the DC area, because this is an organization that is ceremonial for DC. It's not a traveling organization at all. We did some traveling, but that wasn't our focus. So there were some, many, many stories, some of which I can and some of which I cannot tell. But it was really, just an extraordinary experience to be in the White House behind the scenes, to see all the goings on behind the scenes. I was actually in the Vice President's house in December of 2000, the night that Al Gore conceded the election. And I watched his aide type the speech that he ultimately gave, because I was in that office waiting to go on to play for a party that he had that night. I think that, that was just an extraordinary, I hope you all remember that night, that he came out on national television. Well, he gave the same speech at 7 o'clock at his house to the invited guests, so we had some security. So as soon as I got in the car, heading home, I picked up and called my dad, who lives in South Dakota, and said, Dad, you're not gonna believe this. Turn on the TV, you're gonna hear something really extraordinary tonight. And some of these people are actually really, really charming and enchanting, and they're not as wooden as they might appear on television, or stiff. The only person who was exactly the same on TV as he was in live person was Dan Quayle. He always looked, no matter what you saw, he always looked like a deer in the headlights syndrome. That was his look. There was nothing against it, but that was always his look. While in D.C., the beauty of being with the Army Band, not only did I go through basic training where I'm an expert at throwing grenades and firing an M16 rifle, thank God I never used that. You end up with a band, and your primary and secondary focus is the music, right? Frequently, for other military folks, your primary is whatever your specialty is, your secondary is, in the Army, it's infantry. Ours wasn't. I don't think they trusted the Army band guns, but I will tell you a short story about that, and that up until the mid-70s, I think it was, every year you would have to qualify using these rifles. And the Army Band was no exception. You'd have to go in and you'd have to go to a rifle range and show that you could still shoot an M16. So the Army Band made a big deal. The wives all packed up picnics. They went down to Southern Virginia to this rifle range. They had a great day of it. And then and of course, I mean, it's hard to say this, up until the mid-70s, it was an all-male institution. It wasn't until 73 or 74 that women were starting to be admitted into the Army Band. So all the guys were there shooting, everything's going great. They do really well. They get back home, it's a beautiful day, they have a picnic, great time with the family. They get home, the commanding general of the Military District of Washington says, it's not possible that these musicians are shooting better and more accurately than the 3rd Infantry. I don't believe it. So he made them go back and do it again. The wives did not go. It was no picnic. It was a rainy, miserable day. And the band decided, we're going to show them. They did even better. And ever since then, we've never had to qualify on the 16th. We could not be shown that we were better than the 3rd Infantry. But the beauty of being with the band is that they also allowed you to work outside the band. And so I mentioned being the opera conductor, that's what they wanted to do. So I got involved with something slightly similar, with a large symphonic chorus. And I became the associate music director of the Choral Arts Society of Washington, a tutored voice choir that would sing frequently at the Kennedy Center. They were the ones that sang for the opening of the Kennedy Center for Leonard Bernstein's Mass. Remember that? And really an extraordinary institution. And I had was able to get back to my vocal roots out of that. And then ultimately decided it was time to leave DC, came here. And that was due to a couple of things, but primarily Ed Alley and June LaBelle, if you know those two, they had a lot to do with my being here. And so I'd like to play another piece for you. This is also in the key of D major, but radically different than the Solaire that you heard before. This one is I Rock On and Off, and it's one of its preludes. So it's a prelude in D major. Thank you. I'll tell you just a couple of quick stories, and I'll play one last thing for you, Liam. I think that in the first, the second session we had, Don Brenn and Eddie Tobin were talking about playing, you know, popular music and stuff like that. Well, certainly, you have to pick that up along the way, especially if you're with the Army Band. And before I joined the band, however, I was asked to play for a party for a friend. And the friend was not able to play this party, something he'd done every year in Georgetown. And so the woman who was hosting the party wanted to meet me. So I went over to her house to meet her, and she led me into the living room. The living room was probably twice the size of this room here, with about five different seatings in it, and a huge concert grand Steinway. Oh, this is going to be fun. I love this party. And she said, so what would you play? I said, well, I played, you know, probably this, that, that, blah, blah, that. She said, well, show me. So I did the following.
She said, what would you play? I said, well, you like... She said, well, what else? I said, well... something livelier. I said, well, yeah. Going on? She said, well, it's a holiday party too. What else would you do? I said, well, you know,
along those lines, just, you know, showing her, you know, okay, this is what I would play, something like that. Well, she said, fine, thank you. And then I left. I got a call from the booking agency that said, she's decided not to have the party. Or at least she's not going to have a piano player at the party. So why is that? I mean, I don't understand. I mean, what happened? She said, well, why don't you tell us what you did? So I told her. I said, you know, I played this, I played that. I said, you know, it'd be a little bit of this, a little bit of that. She said, oh. Well, the woman said you didn't know how to play the pieces all the way to the end. We're going to go just a slight bit longer than I intend to, Gail, if that's okay. I'm going to end up the playing-wise with something that became a signature piece of mine while I was with the Army. It was something I would play frequently at some of their concerts. And this is from a 1950s movie called Dangerous Missions. And it was written by a British composer, Richard Adinsell. And you will probably know by its title, The Warsaw Concerto. So this is, but you have to imagine, this is now, it was styled after a Rachmaninoff piano concerto. So you have to imagine that I have a 100-piece orchestra behind me. But that's actually going to be coming out of the piano as well as the piano part. So it's an interesting arrangement that has everything in it. So I hope you enjoy this. Oh, I have to ask one question. Are any of you country music fans here? It's okay. We're amongst friends. You can raise your hands. You will hear in the second theme the opening notes of Stand By Your Man. that's just the, you know, the little life of the concert pianist, so to speak. That's my fantasy life, because actually, you know, I do other things. So this is now my opportunity to introduce Gail Berenson, who's a wonderful colleague here and moved here to Sarasota just a couple of years ago. From Ohio. You were at Ohio University. Ohio State University. Ohio University, yes. The Ohio University, sorry. But Gail, please come up and look forward to hearing our story.
Okay, well, it's a pleasure to be here with you all and to talk about, to reminisce and to talk about how I got started in all of this. Being a pianist offers so many opportunities, and there's so many, as you can tell from what Joe was saying, so many different things that one can do. It's vast, and it truly, the piano is versatile. So let me just tell you that when I was five, my mother, it seems that parents are always involved in this decision about early instruction, decided that I should take music lessons, and I lived in Kenosha, Wisconsin. She thought it would be great if I learned to play the harp. Well, living in Kenosha, Wisconsin, number one, there were no harps to buy, and if you bought them, it was very expensive. And number two, you would have to go to Chicago for lessons, which was an hour and a half away. So that was thrown out. That was a no. And so I started studying with a local teacher on piano. So we went with a horizontal harp. She was an Oberlin-trained pianist, very much by the books, play what's on the page, use the fingering that's on the page, play the dynamics that are on the page. But the interesting thing about her was that she also conducted the Snap-on Tools male chorus. So it was the corporate chorus of 40 guys, and they performed all over the state of Wisconsin and into Illinois. And when I was 11, she asked me to become one of their accompanists. And so I was 11. So my father accompanied me to all the rehearsals. And it turned out that it was a wonderful experience because, number one, I learned to read everything very fast, learn things very quickly. Number two, I learned some of the skills of choral accompanying, where you're reading open score because you've got the tenor, first tenor, second tenor, first baritone, you know, all the different parts, and they're all spaced apart. So you have to learn to get your eyes to focus on a much wider range than just the two staffs. I also learned, she taught me that when you play in the introduction, you are providing the mood for the piece. And you want them to want to come in and want to join you in what you're conveying. That was very important because as I continued through junior high and through high school, I always ended up playing for the choruses. And so it was, I had those skills already from the age of 11. So that was terrific. So then I decided, okay, it's time to pick a college and what am I going to major in? And it just seemed natural to major in music. And because I'd been involved in all these choruses and choirs, I thought, okay, I'll do music education and be a choral music ed major. And so I auditioned at Northwestern, and which was nearby in Evanston, Illinois, and I decided, there was a teacher at Northwestern who had adjudicated the competition that I was in, and he had written very astute comments, and I thought this would really be a great person to study with. His name was Louis Crowder, who really was a wonderful teacher. When I got to Northwestern, he did some really unusual things. First of all, I learned later that he attended autopsies so that he could see how. So that he could see how the body worked. And so that, you know, he could see what happens when you pull on the tendon. And the interesting thing about that is when I got to Ohio University and started a wellness course, I took my students to the medical school and we went to the cadaver lab. And those students got to see how a tendon operated. And the singers got to see a real diaphragm. So, and nobody passed out. I didn't lose any students in the process. But at any rate, he was a wonderful teacher. The other thing that he did differently is he overlapped lessons. So I got to see, I would come half an hour early and would watch the student ahead of me, and he was a senior. I don't know what he thought about a freshman coming early to watch him, but anyway, and then he would stay for a half hour after and be there as a part of my lesson. So we learned a lot from each other, and it was just a tremendous experience. Well, about the middle of the year, Mr. Crowder said to me, you know, I really think that you should be a performance major rather than a music ed major. And so I called my parents, and then they came down to Evanston, and we had this big powwow of should she change majors or not. And my father goes, how are you going to earn a living? And that was a good question. But at any rate, they agreed that I would do that. And so I switched majors. At the end of my freshman year, Luke Crowder actually left to go to the University of Connecticut in Storrs. He asked me if I wanted to go as well. My parents said no to that. So I stayed in Evanston. And I ended up switching to a very unique teacher who, a fine pedagogue, way ahead of his time. He believed in discovery learning. So lots of open-ended questions. He would ask questions like, why do you suppose Beethoven put that sforzando in the music? Well, you know, there are all kinds of cues coming from the notes. But, you know, at the time, being asked that question as an undergrad for the first time, and I'm going, how should I know? He's dead and I can't ask him. So at any rate, I learned to think for myself. His goal was to make every student independent. He also believed in group instruction, and I was in a group with two other students. Actually, one of them taught at the University of Oregon after she graduated. The other one is still teaching at Oberlin. And so it was a wonderful experience because you hear all this repertoire. You learn everybody's repertoire. You learn to make constructive feedback and offer good comments. You always have a two-piano partner or an accompanist for your concerto. So it was just a wonderful experience. I have to tell you an interesting story between my sophomore year and junior year. That summer, I decided to go to the Interlochen Arts Academy in Interlochen, Michigan. And I was hired as a staff accompanist. And accompanist was used in those days. And the person that I was assigned to, her studio, was Janice Harshangi. I don't know if any of you know that name. Actually, I heard a recording of hers when I was up there with her singing Carmina Burana, the soloist to Carmina Burana, the org piece, with Eugene Normandy. And I had that vinyl recording. And it was wonderful performing with all of her students. And of course, again, you learn to sight read very, very quickly. You learn to read everything that's put in front of you because you get the music. Maybe you get it a day ahead, maybe not. Maybe you're reading it at the student's lesson. It was the same thing. I also ended up playing loads of auditions at Northwestern. And when you get to, you're on the college faculty, if you're hiring new faculty, they also, you know, any new faculty member in performance coming in, a violinist, a clarinetist, you're playing for them. So, which means you have to learn this stuff really fast. And usually you only get it a day ahead or maybe, again, just the day of. But with Janice Harshangi, she was to do a series of recitals throughout Michigan that summer. Her pianist broke his arm. And so she said to me, would you be willing to play? And I said, sure, I'd be honored. And so I ended up traveling with her, and it was my very first flight ever. Just to move quickly on, when I graduated, got my graduate degree, I decided I would apply for some teaching positions, and there was a position at the University of Illinois, and I was hired to teach class piano, to supervise the student-teacher program and the pedagogy program, and to teach pedagogy, to co-teach pedagogy with a very famous pedagogue at the time, James Life, who was on their faculty. So that was a wonderful experience. And I decided after several years there that I really did want to teach performance majors, and that was a separate department at Illinois. So I looked at other positions and ended up at Ohio University, where I remained for 40 years, 23 as chair of the keyboard division. So, you know, and playing for, the good thing about being a college faculty member is that you play for everybody. All of your colleagues are looking for pianists to play with them, and they are doing annual recitals on campus, but they're also taking the programs on the road. And what I discovered about that is that, you know, doing these one-shot deals is one thing. When you take a program and you tour with it, it gets better at every performance. It was a real learning experience. And so what I wanted to do is to share with you a piece of collaborative performance with friends and colleagues, Peg and Herb Walker. They live in University Park with me, and I got to meet them after I moved here, and it's been really fun making music with them. The Mendelssohn D minor trio is a terrific piece. So let me have them come up here because we're running low on time. While they're talking, let me just say something about collaborative performance. Collaborative performance with strings and with other instruments too. So you notice we have a piano on tall stick. I'm hoping that that's going to work in here. We'll see. There's also a short stick. And then I wanted to show you the other good friend of every collaborative performance, and that's the black block. And so, you know, the whole idea is to keep the piano at least open a little bit for clarity. And so this is a very handy dandy little thing that I take with me wherever I go. Okay, we'll do this with full stick and see how it goes. And could I ask you folks to say something about yourselves?
Sure.
Hi,
everybody. We are amateur, in the true sense of the word, people who love what they do. Both of us had different professional careers. I did play professionally for a while, but we relocated to another city and another situation, and I was playing and I was teaching, and I decided that we met at Interlochen playing chamber music together. That's how we met. And it would have precluded, in the move, it would have precluded our having time at night to play for chamber music because he was working full time. So I decided, we happened to move to Hartford, and I decided, well, get a job, a day job, and in the insurance industry. And as it turned out, because I was lucky enough to be the right person in the right place at the right time, director of marketing technology for the Travelers Insurance Company for a while. And then I retired and ultimately here. I'll let you tell your story. But anyway, we met at Interlochen, and we've been playing chamber music together for 40 years with friends and people that we have grown to love, and it's amazing how much you learn about somebody.
I'm a herb. I'm a much better engineer than I am a cellist. I'll do my best today. One of the things that balance is a big problem in this thing. You know, when you get to orchestras, they, it takes 10 cellos to equal one piano, you know, in the atmosphere. So she really has to show a little mercy for us. But when it's full open, you know, it's just such a lovely sound out of hearing. So I'd much rather be a little bit drowned out. But she does a wonderful job of keeping the balance. But it's not easy. You got to give her credit. She, if she put less out, all the stops were dead. But here we go.
Thank you. Thank you.